right. Ah. Well, first of all, I'd like to thank all of you who braved the cold and snow to get here. The last time I was actually gave a talk 2 weeks ago in Detroit, and they did have a foot of snow, so it's kind of amazing. I'm calling this talk Adventures of a Vatican Astronomer, and I realize that sounds very egotistical, but it is. And before I get into that, and a little show of humility, I wanted to start out by giving a little video about the Vatican Observatory itself, because so many people ask, why does the Vatican have an observatory? And I thought, rather than me up here talking, I'd let somebody who's much better at describing it do the talking.
Both science and religion.
There are ways of learning how we interact with this universe. It's not simply a question of, is there a God? But there is a God, how would we do? It's not just a question of, there are a bunch of stars, but rather, why are there stars? How do they work? How does that tell us how things work here on Earth? The interaction that I see in my own life is that religion gives me the reason to do the science.
Back in the papacy before Francis was Benedict, and one of his lines in a final allocution to the fathers of the general congregation was, go to the frontiers. Well, there isn't much more frontier than 3.7 billion years away.
The first official interest of the Church for astronomy started in 1582 with the reform of the calendar. Then in 1891, Pope Leo XIII wanted to have an observatory to show that the Church is not against science, but the Church promotes good science.
They start out by having telescopes on Tower of the Winds, and then on the walls surrounding the Vatican, as the city lights grow, and as the Italian government gives them back the territory at Castel Gandolfo, in the 30s they build new telescopes on the roof of the Papal Palace in Castel Gandolfo, best telescopes of their era in the 1930s. By the 1980s, light pollution makes those telescopes unusable, so we build a new telescope in the dark skies of Arizona. Human beings look at the stars and wonder, They want to know, what is that? What is that about? How do I fit in? They hear about the moon landing, and they want to know, what was that like? If we're part of the human race, we're part of the race that went to the moon. We're part of the species that looked at the stars and went, what the heck are those things? Looking at the sky reminds you that there's more to the universe than what's for lunch. What's more, if you believe in the universe, that God so loved that he sent his son, then not only are you going to want to study the universe because it's kind of cool, it's an act of worship. It's an act of getting closer to the Creator and getting closer to a universe, as St. Athanasius said 1500 years ago, was cleansed and quickened by the Incarnation. Then, doing science is an act of worship.
So a few years ago, I had a chance to use the largest telescope in the world, which is the 10-meter telescope in Hawaii on Mauna Kea. And the way this works when you're an astronomer and you ask for telescope time on a national observatory like that one, if they give you the time, they give you the chance to use it. They buy your plane ticket to come out to Hawaii. They give you a place to stay overnight. It's all part of the package deal. So we flew out, three of us, to Hawaii. Now, we only get one night on the telescope, and the telescope is up there on Mauna Kea at about 15,000 feet altitude. The air is quite thin. It takes at least a week to really get fully acclimated. They don't want you doing foolish things, which is what happens when you don't have any air. So they have you working remotely from a little town called Waimea, which is halfway up the mountain. And it's actually quite convenient because you're in a town, you can actually walk outside of the control room and go to McDonald's and buy a hamburger and come back and have something to eat while you're reserving. Unfortunately, you don't really know what's going on up the mountain. You've got to talk to people through a television command, and once you've set up the command, then all of these screens tell you what's going on at the telescope. You can tell them to move the telescope to a certain direction. The people at the top of the mountain will do that. And then you collect your data and you can see what's coming down through those screens on this dedicated line. Unfortunately, that day when we talked to the people up in the mountain, what they told us was, it's snowing. We're not going to open the telescope unless it clears. It doesn't look like it's going to clear. Flew all that way for nothing. It happens. Well, one guy in the group stayed up and the other two of us went to bed. And I wake up the next morning, hadn't cleared at all. But I realize it's Sunday morning. And I'm a good Catholic kid. And I'm not a priest, I'm a brother, which means I've got to find somebody to say Mass for me. So I look up on the internet and I find that there is, in fact, next to the McDonald's, a Catholic church in town. And they've got Mass at 8:30 in the morning. And I look, it's only 7 in the morning. I can walk there in time. So I go in, and it's this beautiful church. I've taken these pictures off the internet. I was sitting pretty much over there, as I recall. Of course, this is Hawaii. Pastor gets up before Mass. Do we have any visitors here? And of course, it's Hawaii. Half the people are visitors. So where are you from? Anyone who's a visitor, stand up. And, oh, you're from Ohio. Welcome. And you've come from Tennessee. That's great. And, you know, and you're from California. And he's going down. Everybody who stands up, I'm the last one. And you, sir. And I stand and I tell them the honest truth. I'm an observer from the Vatican. I'd wanted to use that line for years. But I am an observer from the Vatican. And the telescope that I normally use is actually neither at the Vatican nor in Hawaii, but it's located on a mountain just south of Safford. If you ever want to go see it, you go to Discovery Park in Safford, Arizona, and on Saturdays they have little tours that go up to visit the telescope. It's only at 10,000 feet, which is still pretty darn good. It's a really dark site, it's a really dry site, the air is very stable, and what's best of all, we've got a phenomenal mirror in our telescope. Now it's 1.8 meters across. It's 6 feet. As telescopes go, it's not that big anymore. But small telescopes are actually where discoveries are made. The reason I got the time on the big telescope is because we had made some interesting discoveries on the colors of the objects out beyond Pluto. Basically, they're faint. You have to wait 5 minutes just to get enough of a signal that you can measure it. But we found that people have discovered 1,000 of these objects. They seem to come in two colors. There's not a gradation of colors. There's not only one color. There are two distinct colors. We wanted to get fainter objects, smaller objects with a bigger telescope. Eventually we did. We found that that holds even to the smaller objects. But I want to tell you a little bit more about this mirror itself, because this telescope mirror is one of the amazing things that makes our telescope so wonderful. Why do astronomers use telescopes? What does a telescope do? Most of us think of telescopes as making faraway things look closer. What you're really saying is that it makes small things look bigger. But have you ever looked at a star through a telescope? Anybody here? What does it look like? Looks like a star. Stars are so small and so far away that even the biggest telescope will still only see them as a point. No, what a telescope does for an astronomer is it makes faint things brighter. And here we've got a telescope that's 1.8, I should say, meters across, 72 inches across. The human eye is only about 6 millimeters across. And this is 1.8 meters, so this is 1,800 millimeters across. So that's 1,800 more times. No, because it's the area, so it's 1,800 times 1,800. It's about 4 million more square centimeters, square millimeters, than your human eye. It can see fainter things. It collects all of that light, and then it concentrates it to a point, and that's the focal point. In the old days, the way you made a mirror like that is you got a huge slab of glass, Corning would make this, and you grind it, and you grind it, and you grind it, and you grind it into a parabola, hoping that it will actually be in focus and that your testing of the focus didn't get messed up the way it did with a Hubble mirror. Or you keep grinding and you grind and you hope that it doesn't crack the mirror, which is what happened to the first 200-inch. And at best, you grind it into a relatively shallow parabola, which means that in order to have the structure to have that second mirror to shine it through the hole at the bottom, you've got to have a really, really, really long telescope. And the longer the telescope, the more it's likely to flex when it moves, which ruins the focus. And the bigger the building you have to have, imagine how expensive it is to build a building this size. Now imagine you had to do this on top of a mountain where everything has to be carried up a dirt road that takes a half an hour to do the last 10 miles. That's expensive. That's tough. But it's worse. You've all learned in freshman physics, those of you who did freshman physics, that a parabola will concentrate a light to a point, focus it to a point. That's lovely. You want your pictures in focus. The fact of the matter is, it's only in focus right in the center of the field of view. And it gets a little bit worse in focus as you move away. So you could have the middle of the moon all sharp focus, and the edge of the moon is all going to be kind of fuzzy. Anybody who's had a big Dobsonian telescope knows this effect. The way you cure that for most telescopes is to have the secondary mirror also curved. Well, there was a fellow in the 1980s named Roger Angel who had a brilliant idea, first of all, of how to make a telescope mirror that was really big and focused really well, and you didn't have to worry about it cracking. You take a pile of glass in a mold in an oven, and you melt the glass, and then you spin the oven. And as it spins, the molten glass forms itself into a parabola. And in fact, you can even form it with little knobs here, so it's got, you know, a rigid hexagonal shape holding it together, and it's only the top that's solid glass. And the faster you spin it, the steeper the parabola. He got some money to try it out, to build his first oven. He found an abandoned building on the University of Arizona campus, an old synagogue. He put it all together, he spun it up, and he made a beautiful 1.8 mirror, 1.8 meters across. And he decided, what the heck, just to see if I can do it, the focal length, the distance from the focal point to the mirror, is the same as the width of the mirror. In camera terms, this is an F1 mirror. Really fast, really bright. No one had ever tried doing that before. The glorious thing is that it worked. Now that he had a beautiful telescope mirror, what's he going to do with it? He doesn't have the money to actually build the telescope. So he came to the Vatican Observatory. This was before I was there. And he said, the University of Arizona now owns this mirror. We'll give it to the Vatican if you'll build a telescope around it. And in that case, we'll have 1/4 of the telescope time. You guys will have 3/4 of the telescope time. And it's all part of a new observatory complex they built in Mount Graham. We went to the Vatican, said, you know, what do you think? And they said, go right ahead. You have our permission to ask some rich people to give you the money to build the telescope. Which we did. And the telescope was built and got first light in 1983. And it's worked great. The nice thing is, the design was by Roger Angel. The Pope has a telescope mirror made by an angel in a synagogue. But for those of you who know your optics, you'll see that most of the time when the old-style telescopes that were really long, in order to cut down the length, they would put the secondary mirror about there, about halfway, and it would be curved convex, because that's how you had to have it curved in that part of the optical path to make it actually come in focus across the entire field of view. And you can't test a convex mirror because it doesn't ever come to focus. So you have to do your best and hope it's pretty good, good enough. But because this was such a fast telescope, it was such a squat telescope, they decided would take advantage of a design by a guy named James Gregory back in the 1820s of having a concave mirror up above the focal point, which the concave mirror you can test. You can make sure that it's absolutely accurate. And if it works, it will give you a really sharp focusing telescope. The one danger is, in the optical design, it turns out you focus the telescope by moving that secondary mirror back and forth a little bit. In order to get this telescope in focus, the secondary mirror has to stay in position to within 5 microns, 5 micrometers. That's half the width of a human hair. We weren't sure we were going to be able to control the mirror that finely, even with computers. But if it worked, it would be so great. We decided to build the Gregorian design. We decided to take a chance, a Gregorian chance. This was just the latest in a long series of wonderful events dating back to the reestablishment of the Vatican Observatory in 1891, which will be 125 years next year. Pope Leo XIII had become pope at a time when the Vatican was in something of a crisis. With the unification of Italy, the Italian government had confiscated all church property. That means they have to pay the upkeep on all those old churches. It's wonderful. But it also meant that the Vatican insisted it was still an independent country, even if it was nothing more than the area around St. Peter's. And the Italian government says, no, it's only because we're nice that we haven't marched in and arrested you. The Vatican was desperate to be recognized as an independent country. So they have their own currency and their own postage stamps and their own national observatory. But in addition, there was another reason and a more important reason. It was only at the end of the 19th century that the myth began about there being a war between science and religion. Before about 1850, nobody thought of there being such a war because, frankly, half the people doing the science were clergymen. In those days, in any given village, who else had the education and the free time to keep track of the weather, the climate, the local flora and fauna? It was always the Reverend so-and-so. You can look up in all of the books of the Transactions of the Philosophical Society in the 1700s, and half of the authors are going to be, you know, a local nobleman, or a medical doctor, or a clergyman, the Reverend so-and-so. But at the end of the 19th century, for a lot of political reasons, the myth began that the church was anti-science, so the Pope wanted to show that everyone could see that the church actually supports good science. Eventually, they made their peace with the Italian government. The Italian government now recognizes the Vatican as an independent country. I've got a Vatican passport that allows me to get in and out. I'm not a Vatican citizen, I'm a US citizen. And we still have the mission of showing the world that the church is supporting good science. When I arrived at the Vatican, I was told by the director the same thing that I'll tell any new person coming. Your job at the Vatican Observatory is do good science, which means I'm free to do any science that I feel like doing. I don't have to worry about sitting on committees. I don't have to worry about submitting proposals. I don't have to worry about getting approval from some funding agency. I don't have to worry about getting results within the 3-year lifetime of a proposal to NSF. I don't have to worry about getting results within the 6-year lifetime of a tenure process at a university. As a result, we can do very long-term projects. One of the projects was using one of the series of telescopes, there are 18 of them, identical telescopes, to photograph the sky. And the Vatican Observatory was one of the national observatories accepted in this project. We photographed the sky to be able to make the first really accurate photographic map. It took more than 80 years for all those photographs to be made and the positions measured and the catalogs made. There's now a new telescope that we're affiliated with in a loose way that will do the same thing 3 times a week. The power of computers. We had a second telescope, photographic telescope, installed in the 50s, and this is Pope Paul VI, the night of the moon landing, who spoke to the astronauts from a worldwide television setup. Remember how exciting that was? It had only been around for about 6 months when the Pope used it, and the cameras were in our telescope dome as he gave his greetings to the astronauts on the moon. By the 1930s, we'd moved out to the Pope's summer home. And it's a beautiful place, but you can see the church literally supporting 2 telescope domes. Lovely telescopes there. What was nice is that the Pope actually lives, when the Pope was using this as a summer home, Pope Francis doesn't anymore. But the Pope would be living in those quarters, and in those days, the top floor were our offices, so that was my office. I could be, in claim at least, the only guy in the Catholic Church above the Pope. But the Popes were very good to us and met us a number of times over the years. So back in the days when my beard was still red, I got to meet Pope John Paul II. And when we dedicated new offices in 2009, Pope Benedict came out. This is a picture of him holding one of my meteorites. This is a meteorite we believe comes from Mars. And it's really exciting. This picture was on the front page of the Vatican newspaper, L'Osservatore Romano. I was able to tell my mom, I'm on the front page! Because you see this little strip of black there? That's my shoulder. And I can prove it, because here's the picture taken from the other side. And there's the guy with the picture that... And of course, even Pope Francis has been at our place. He came for lunch. I showed him one of the meteorites that actually fell in Argentina. And all of the popes, even though they come from very different backgrounds, have all been very, very supportive. Pope Francis, you don't think of him as being an intellectual German professor the way that Benedict was. But he's a Jesuit. He understands the role of the intellectual life. In fact, there was a young fellow, also Argentinian, studying astronomy, who was wondering if he should be a Jesuit. And he went to a very young, this was 30 years ago, Father Bergoglio, young Jesuit in Argentina. And Father Bergoglio told this young man, stay and finish your degree, and then if you want to join the Jesuits, we'd be welcome to have you, and maybe we'll run into each other again someday. That was Father Funes, our previous director. So he and the Pope had this personal connection, which I don't have, but I'm hoping the Pope will still like us. And the fact is that they've been very good at setting up this beautiful lab, coming to visit it. I mean, when the Pope uses the microscope, he's already got his white coat. He's clearly a scientist. What is the work that we do? It was mentioned that I've got access. My new job, I was the curator of the meteorite collection. What do you do with meteorites? This was actually a practical question that I had to deal with. I showed up, I was told, do good science, you know meteorites, we've got 1,142 meteorites, do whatever you guys do with meteorites. Well, what do you do with meteorites? There's a rock, and there's a... Most of the work in meteoritics has been making thin sections, shining light through them, measuring, this is less than a millimeter across, it's a microscopic view, and you want to measure the chemical composition of a meteorite to incredibly high precision, and that's done nowadays with incredibly delicate machinery that takes incredibly expensive people to keep it running. We don't have that. What's more, I've got friends who do have that. If I did want it, I'd just take them and bring the piece to them. On the other hand, back in the days when I did theory before I had a meteorite collection, the science is divided into the experimentalists and the theorists, and oftentimes they don't talk to each other very well. I was doing theory and I was worried about, I want to have numbers to plug into my computer program. What is the heat capacity of a rock? What is it? And I couldn't find these numbers for the meteorites. Internal war between the theorists and the experimentalists. The experimentalists won't let you, they won't make the measurements that I want. I remember in Rome, I was talking to a little meeting of scientists, and one of the guys at the table, this was after the meeting, and we're all sitting drinking coffee, and he's going on, he says, the trouble with this field are the terrorists. We cannot trust terrorists. Terrorists never are interested in what we're doing. Terrorists will never, and I realized as he's ranting about terrorists that he was not speaking English. He couldn't pronounce the TH. Theorists who you could never trust. Theorists who are going to destroy the... Well, I used to be one of those theorists. Now I had access to a meteorite collection. I wanted to know, what's the density of a rock? Because that goes into the theory of how many of these rocks do you have inside an asteroid of a given type. And no one had ever measured them. No one had ever measured the density of a meteorite. Well, pretty much nobody. How do you measure the density? What's density? Why does density tell you anything? It's Christmas, right? When I was a little kid, I was allowed to open one present before going to church on Christmas morning. You sound familiar? And so you had to make sure it was a good present. I mean, you didn't want to open a box of socks. Right? Your one present. No, you had to be like a book or a box of chocolate or something. How do you tell whether a box has got chocolate or socks in it? Density. The density. How much stuff is in the given volume. That tells you what's inside the material. But how do you measure the density of something that's irregular like a rock? Mass divided by volume. Mass is easy, you put it on a scale. Volume? How do you measure the volume of something irregular? You can't put it in water because these rocks are very delicate and they're completely out of equilibrium. They're rusting in the air as it is because they've got little flecks of metallic iron that make them fall apart. You put them in water and boy, are they going to rust. No one will let you do that, which is why nobody had done it. I needed a fluid that wouldn't rust. Well, meanwhile, I'm working in Rome, and one of the things that happens in Italy, of course, is all work stops at 10 o'clock. We've got this big industrial strength cappuccino machine, and I'm having cappuccino, and I'm pouring sugar into the cappuccino, and it suddenly dawns on me, sugar looks like a fluid. Little white beads would work even better. But of course, the beads would act as a fluid that goes all the way around the rock without going into any of the cracks. The other way to do it is to use a gas like helium that goes into all of the cracks. And the two different methods are going to give you two different volumes because one includes the volume of the cracks, the other doesn't include the volume of the cracks. I've just measured the volume of the cracks. So I've also just measured the porosity. How fluffy or not fluffy are these rocks? The way we measure, of course, the bead system is easy. We've got a cup here. I know the measurement. It says 1/2 cup right there. We actually measure a little more accurately than that. Pour in the beads, shake them, scrape them, put them on a pan, and you know what the density of the beads is. Dump it out, put in the rock, pour the rest of the area with beads, shake it, scrape it, weigh it. And the difference in the weight tells you the difference in the density. And that's the outside bulk density. Here, you put the rock in this container, you plug it up, you pressure that side to 2 atmospheres of helium, this side is at 1 atmosphere of helium, you open the valve, and the bigger the rock, the less space there is for the extra helium, so the higher the final pressure. All you have to do then is to have some object of known volume that you can use to calibrate the system. So we went and found these wonderfully machined calibration spheres, which are color-coded and numbered 1 to 15, solids and stripes. It turns out, eventually, that for smaller objects, we can even use a commercial gizmo that does all of it, and it's computerized and works marvelously. And to make sure that the beads are done right, I hired a minion. Bob Mackey, who is now the curator of meteorites. This was Bob about 10 years ago. And having a grad student, now Dr. Bob, doing all of this work meant that he has gone not only to our collection, but to a dozen other collections around the United States and a couple in Europe. He has probably handled more meteorites than anybody else I know because he has made thousands of measurements of many different types of meteorites, and he's so good at it that he's now brought in by the people in Houston to make measurements on the densities of the moon rocks brought back by the Apollo people. So he's actually handled real moon rocks. And because it's really useful to have minions, and also useful to have an idea of how to proceed from here, we've now got a new system that shines a laser beam. And it's got a couple of minions there to help him out. So that as this turntable spins, the laser beam allows you to put together a 3D model. And that means you don't even have the beads touching the rocks anymore. That was one measurement we made. Another was, how do you measure the amount of heat in a meteorite? Because I want to know how dense is the planet made out of meteorites and how much heat it takes to warm them up. Imagine a pot of liquid nitrogen, and you drop the meteorite in the liquid nitrogen. Well, before you drop in the meteorite, liquid nitrogen is slowly evaporating away, and so the mass, the weight of this pot is dropping. You drop in the meteorite. Another gizmo here. You drop in the meteorite, the weight pops up. It boils like mad, so all sorts of liquid nitrogen goes away. This is the amount of liquid nitrogen that's boiled away. That tells you how much heat came out of the rock. By knowing the amount of heat that the meteorites can absorb, we can now calibrate the amount of heat actually seen being absorbed and radiating away from the asteroids. We can calibrate how much heat it takes to warm up a meteorite as it's subjected to radioactive heating. By knowing the density of the meteorite, you can picture, imagine if you will, a body made out of rock and ice all mixed together. There are bodies like that, and now that I know the density of the meteorite stuff, I can tell you how much of rock is in Europa, which has got a density of about 3, but we know it's covered in ice, which is to say lots of rock, not a whole lot of ice. It will melt. When it melts, the rock is going to fall to the bottom, the water go to the top, there will be an icy crust, an ocean, and then rock underneath, and maybe even little fishies swimming in the ocean, who knows? We came up with this idea not knowing the density. Now that we know the density, we can make these models much more precisely. But even better than that, most of the meteorites have a density about 3 times the density of water. We've now measured the density of the asteroids where they came from. And the density of the asteroids, which are exactly the same spectra, exactly the same color, the same composition, but they only have half the density of the meteorites that come from them. Asteroids are not big lumps of rock. They're piles of rubble, loose piles of rubble. So what? If one of these asteroids is coming at Earth and you want to move it out of the way, and you send Bruce Willis up there, if it was a rock, he could set off his atomic bomb and blow it to smithereens, and maybe even move it. But if it's a pile of rubble, it absorbs the blast without breaking apart, without doing anything. It completely changes the way you have to move these things about, if you're worried about. On the other hand, if there's an asteroid like that coming towards Earth, and instead of sending Bruce Willis up there, you send somebody up with a bucket and a spade, and they start shoveling it into the buckets to bring it back to Earth because it's full of useful minerals. Knowing how to exploit the meteorite also depends on how loosely packed it is. And finally, if you're running away from the Empire and you want to find an asteroid, you'll have a hope that maybe there's a crack big enough for the Millennium Falcon to fly into. All of these things come from the measurements that we made, mostly because we wanted to make measurements and didn't really know why we wanted to make the measurements. Where do the meteorites come from? They come from the asteroid belt. Yeah, well, how do they go from the asteroid belt to my collection? Most of the time when a meteorite falls from the sky, it lands on the ground and it looks just like all the other rocks and you'll never see it. And it starts to rust like mad and it falls apart within a couple of years. Unless it falls in a dry desert, and one of the best deserts is Antarctica, where it's kept cold for so long that the meteorite will stay untouched for thousands of years. And in 1996, I was part of a team that went looking for meteorites. In fact, that's me. So right in my jacket there, that's the only way you can tell me apart from all the other members of the team. There were 6 of us in 3 tents like that. We moved out there in early November, set up camp just before Thanksgiving, stayed there until Christmas, 6 weeks. 6 weeks without a shower. Yeah. We ate frozen food, that's where the food was stored, saw that the temperature, the wind chill got to about 70 below at one time. I had the bucket there was for our drinking water. Once a day, you take this ice chipper and you go upwind towards the south. The wind always comes from the south. Chip out the ice, and the clean ice is always upwind, because downwind is, well, every morning I'd wake up, turn on the stove. You couldn't sleep with the stove on because you might roll into the stove. Put on all of your clothes, go outside, start the skidoo, rock it back and forth so it wasn't frozen to the ground. Grab the shovel, go downwind to a snowbank, park the skidoo sideways so that the wind from the south doesn't hit you. Dig a hole in the snowbank and hope you remembered the toilet paper. Why dig a hole? We had one guy who showed up to help fix one of the skidoos who wasn't used to digging the hole. And the next day we kept saying, oh my gosh, look at that dark thing. It must be a meteor. No, never mind. Nowadays, they actually don't even do that. Everything is bagged up and brought back to McMurdo. Which, it was a fabulous adventure. Being that remotely reminded me of the psalm that goes, Lord, you searched me and know me. You know when I sit down, when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. What was more far away than that? Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee? If I take the wings of the morning and settle at the farthest limit of the sea, even there your hand guides me. If I say, surely the darkness will cover me and the light around me become light, even the darkness is not dark, for darkness is as light to you. I was in a place that had 24-hour sunlight. I mean, think of this. I'm an astronomer, right? What are the two things you know? You look up when it's dark. Here I go to a place where it's never dark, and I spent the entire time looking down, looking for meteorites. I did have one adventure. I had bought a new watch before I went down there to be sure I had a really accurate timepiece. And it was the kind where the hands glow in the dark, and I was really good. So I'm waking up in the middle of the night. I leave the watch on to keep it warm. I have no idea what time it is. So I put the watch up, and I cannot see the hands glowing in the dark. I just bought this watch. It's not glowing in the dark. How come I can't see? As I wake up a little more, I remember I'm in Antarctica, where it's always bright. I'm wearing a mask. No wonder I can't see the watch. It was a very difficult experience in a lot of ways. It was fabulous. It was like being on no other planet, but you could never get away from the people you were with. And what I really wanted to do was to go, after I'd spent 6 weeks in Antarctica, go someplace where I could be alone, go someplace where I could finally look at the stars. And we were in New Zealand. Lake Tekapo was not that far from Christchurch, which is your entry point to and from New Zealand. And there's this little lovely chapel there. It's just a beautiful place. Anybody who's been there, it's just gorgeous. And the stars are wonderful. And I was up every night looking at the stars and using my little telescope. I was staying at a bed and breakfast that specializes in fisher people, fishing, that kind of thing. I'm fishing for stars. And one day, the lady who runs it said, you know, you want to come with the family to church with us on Sunday? She knew I was a Jesuit. And that's the church. It's a little, that's Presbyterian one week, Anglican the next week, Catholic the third week, and they sort of cycle through. It was an Anglican week, but I said, sure, I'll go to the church. And she goes, I noticed you talking to some of the tourists who were staying here the other day in German, high school German. It's not great, but it's better than you would expect. She says, maybe you can help out, because that woman that you probably read about will be at the church. What woman is this? There was a German couple who had come to New Zealand, the other side of the world. And while there, the fella stepped back to take a picture and plummeted to his death in front of his wife, who is now suddenly all alone and, oh yeah, doesn't speak English, on the other side of the world. And I'm a Jesuit. Can you talk to her? You speak German. Can you talk? What do you say? What do you say to somebody like that? Well, fortunately, I had learned enough in my theology training to know that you don't say, you listen. I can listen to anybody in any language. But it reminded me that my life as a Jesuit is more than having fun picking up rocks or looking through telescopes. There's also a connection to something that people also need. The Anglican priest would speak English to me, I'd say a few things to her. I hope we did her some good. But it was a moment that suddenly brought all of this work into focus. I had started out as a Sputnik kid. I went, you know, I was in kindergarten when people went around, you know, the first satellite went around. I was, you know, a long-haired college kid when people landed on the moon. I was going to MIT because it had the world's biggest collection of science fiction. Wound up at Arizona with this other group of long hairs, except for the one guy with short hair. He was fresh out of the Navy, and his dad was a Presbyterian minister, so. But all during this time when I was being an astronomer, I kept having this idea in the back of my head, why am I doing astronomy when people are starving in the world? By the time I had been a postdoc, I was pushing 30 years old, I had no answer for that. So in 1983, I quit astronomy, and I joined the Peace Corps. They sent me to Kenya. I lost a lot of weight. The first thing that happened when I went to Kenya was I realized I'm not an adventuresome person. I'm thousands of miles from home. I'm thousands of miles from everybody I know. I'm in a strange place where they eat funny food and they sleep in odd places. And the homesickness just got to me so deeply, so strongly, that I was getting physically ill. And even during training, I realized I didn't have what it takes to be. I could not live this far from home. So I made the decision, tomorrow morning, I'm going to tell the Peace Corps trainers, send me home. They promised, all you have to do is say, I want to go home. You go home on the next plane. No questions asked. Okay, I'll admit it. But if I'm going home tomorrow, I've always wanted to see the Southern Cross. And here I am on the equator. I wonder if I can see it. I pulled out my favorite astronomy book. You like astronomy? The book to get is H.A. Rey's book, The Stars. H.A. Rey is the guy who wrote Curious George, so it's great for kids. I still had a copy when I was 30, because it's also great for grown-ups. And I pulled out the book, and it said that at 4 in the morning on the equator on this particular day, the Southern Cross should be rising. So I got up in the morning, and there it was, the Southern Cross, and Alpha and Beta Centauri, and all of these stars that I had never seen before. And I thought, that was great. But I look a little bit further up, and oh, my gosh, there's Orion and the dog. And I keep looking all the way to the north, and in the opposite direction, there's the Big Dipper above the horizon. And all of these stars that I had learned as a kid. And suddenly it hit me, I'm not away from home. Where I can see the stars, I'm always at home. And there's no reason to be homesick. And what's more, these are pretty wonderful things to see. So I stayed. I stayed 2 years. I gave lectures. I got a little telescope and brought it with me and looked at the skies there. I even had an astronomy club that I set up with the kids at a high school where I helped out at. They built these little models of space stations because Kenya is a marvelous place to launch satellites because you're right at the equator where the Earth is moving the fastest, and if you launch to the east, you've got the Indian Ocean, so if something goes wrong, it falls in the ocean, not on your neighbor. And these kids at this exhibit that I helped them set up were able to describe all of this to Daniel Arap Moi, the president of Kenya. This was a school of, it was an orphanage, but a really good orphanage. Great, the best students in the country got to come here. And also, a couple of children of the elite to make it sort of work out, and you have the elite take a look at this place. So this one kid gives a whole description of how you can launch satellites from Kenya to the president. And the president is quite impressed. And one of the president's aides standing behind him, this very well-dressed woman, walks up to the kid afterwards, gives him a big hug, and the kid goes, "Oh, Mom!" Because kids are the same everywhere, boys especially. Kids are the same everywhere. People are the same everywhere. I had gone to Africa because I wanted to do something worthwhile, better than astronomy. And what the Africans asked me to do was teach them astronomy. And every weekend I'd go, I was teaching actually astronomy at the university. But every weekend I'd go upcountry with a little telescope and I'd set it up and everybody in the village would come out and look at, you ever seen the moon through a telescope? You ever seen Saturn and its rings through a telescope? Have you ever seen Saturn and its rings and not gone, wow? Because that's what human beings do. You go outside, you look at the stars and wonder. It sounds like that movie. Because that's what, I had a very clever cat when I was in Kenya. The cat never wanted to look through the telescope. Human beings want to look through the telescope. Human beings are hungry for the knowledge about what it means to look at the universe and to wonder what are those lights in the sky and how can we figure out our place there. Even knowing we'll never have answers, to have the ability to ask the questions and then to ask the questions in an intelligent way. That was feeding people who were starving every bit as if they were starving for food, because human beings don't live by bread alone. I think I read that someplace. It eventually, of course, led me to the Jesuits. It led me to the Vatican Observatory.
Why does the Vatican have an astronomical observatory? For instance, you're the curator of meteorites at the Vatican. Why do they curate meteorites? Are they looking for the shooting star of David?
No, in fact, the whole idea of having astronomers really got started with the reform of the calendar back in the 1500s. And since then, just studying the universe is a great way to remind yourself that there's more important things in life than what's for lunch.
What is for lunch?
What is for lunch?
That's for lunch. The heavens proclaiming the glory of God. That's why we do astronomy. Thank you all for coming. Thank you very much. And do we have time for questions?
We have time for questions.
Yeah. Yes.
You mentioned that one of the meteorites you thought was from Mars. How the world do you...
What's that? Ain't in Mars.
Benedict asked exactly that same question. And so I was able to tell him, because di sotto perché si fare in questo meteorite è possibile di... There are, in fact, this is one of these things we're pretty confident about, because there are three or four different independent lines of evidence that all say Mars. All the meteorites in our collection come from the asteroid belt. They come from bodies that have never melted, for the most part. These meteorites have melted. The meteorites that are not melted all have an age of 4.5 billion years, the age of the sun, the age of the earth. These meteorites, I mean, even the moon rocks are rarely younger than 3 billion years. The idea is, the bigger the body, the longer it can hold on to its heat, the longer it will be making rocks. So the Earth is really big, and it can make rocks today. You go to Hawaii. These meteorites have an age less than 1 billion years. So they came from a body bigger than the moon, which is bigger than any asteroid, but smaller than the Earth. There's, like, only Mars does that. All of these meteorites are full of metallic iron, like I mentioned. These meteorites aren't. The Mars ones are oxidized and have carbon dioxide-based minerals in them, as if they came from an atmosphere planet. All of this suggested Mars. Then a theorist, one of those terrible terrorists, works out and says, it's impossible for rocks to be launched off of something as big as Mars. I can show you with my numbers. Then somebody took one of these so-called Mars rocks and discovered that it had been cracked when it was launched. And when it cracked, the rocks between the cracks melted and then froze. And when it froze with bubbles. So you can carve around the bubble, put the piece of molten frozen glass into a vacuum, into a mass spectrometer, melt the glass, the bubble bursts, and every atom goes whooshing down this mass spectrometer, and you count atom by atom the abundances in the air in the bubble, and it's not Earth air. It matches exactly the atmosphere of Mars. And at that point, you go, okay, the theorist screwed up. If it did happen, it can happen. And the theorist goes, oh, I can explain that too. And finally, they agree that they come from Mars. Yeah?
I have two good questions. One is that easy, the other one is more complicated. If you mentioned one telescope is 15,000, one was maybe 10,000.
Yeah.
It seems so, like that's, you're looking at things so far away. Would that 5,000 feet make any difference?
The difference it makes is with the amount of air over the telescope, because it's the Earth's atmosphere that cuts out a lot of the light, especially if there's water vapor in the air, and it makes the, there's more dust in the air when you lower down. You're above about two-thirds of the atmosphere at 15,000 feet. So you've cut down the amount of disturbing of the atmosphere by that much.
Okay, the other question is, I thought I talked last year by Bob Stitzer. Mm-hmm. I'm sure you know him. He used to be the president of Gonzaga.
He's a Jesuit.
Really neat physicist. Mm-hmm. And he, I read his book about the new evidence for the proof of God.
Mm-hmm.
And I, at first I thought, new, how could it be? But yeah. He's got great math in there that explains how it actually is, mm-hmm. and address Hawking's questions. Is there, have you learned anything from your astronomy that helps an atheist grapple with the proof of the existence of God?
No. And what's more, I completely disagree with Bob Spitzer's thesis. I don't think that you can use science to prove the existence of God. And actually, that's not what he's doing. He's using the word proof in the popular sense. Rather, you see, God isn't what I come to at the end of my science. God is what I start with before I do the science. When I look at the universe as a person who believes, I see evidence of God and God's personality, if you will. And I learn lots about how God does things. There are a lot of ways you could have made a universe. God chose to do it this way. There are a lot of ways that God could have sent a savior, you know, on a cloud of glory. Everybody knows this is what's going on. Instead, God chose to come as a baby. That's telling you something about God. To my mind, astronomy tells you about a God who follows the rules he set up, who does things in great economy and great cleverness and great rationality. In the beginning was the word, we read. In arche eta logos. The word for word is logos, the same word as logic. In the beginning was logic. And on top of all that, it's all beautiful. And that tells me something about God. So everything that I see in science completely reaffirms the assumption I made at the beginning that there's a God responsible for it. Now, my atheist friend could believe exactly the opposite. Start with a different assumption. And the choices that they have to make to maintain the non-existence of a God leads them to a universe that's meaningless and despairing. That's what they come up with. They can believe that. I can't disprove that. I can just say, if that's the universe you want to think you believe in, it doesn't, it's not as satisfying, it's not as emotionally elegant a way of looking at the universe. What Spitzer does is he points out basically the enormous number of things that an atheist has to toss out in order to not believe in God. And that's valid. It's not a proof of God any more than if I found a light switch here and I flip the switch and the lights go out, that doesn't prove that the light switch controls the lights, because maybe there's another switch and somebody by accident happened to hit it at the same time. But it's a good enough demonstration that I'm going to rely on that switch if I want to turn the lights off. You know, in a practical sense, it works. we're not out there to search for a proof of God, because I don't need a proof of God. We're out there to learn about creation and in that way get to know the Creator, which St. Paul tells us, you know, in the letter to the Romans, since the beginning of time, that's how God has communicated to us, through the things that God has made. Yeah?
This code has talked about preservation of the environment, mm-hmm. and those types of things. And recently, Tennessee, we just got our first international dark sky park designated.
Yes.
State park. It's very exciting. And our members of my family have visited different international dark sky parks. Has the Vatican taken a position on preservation of dark skies? And
we are member number 7 of the International Dark Sky Association, which is headquartered in Tucson. And so we've been a supporter since the beginning, a dues-paying supporter. The foundation that I'm asking people to remember actually pays a woman named Liz Alvarez, who does coordination with them. So we're big supporters of them. At the same time, we have to keep going. You know, the people who need to know the most that the church supports science isn't the scientists, all my scientist friends. They have their own churches, they know what they're doing. It's the people in the pews. It's the people within my religion. You have to say, don't be afraid of science. Likewise, who do I have to tell to turn off those bright lights on your buildings? The people who are putting bright lights on churches. So it's a long, never-ending fight. But you know, everybody knows how Pope Francis is a big supporter of the environment. Pope Benedict was too. The trouble was that Pope Benedict didn't know how to say it in a friendly way. But you know, he lectured like a German professor, because he was a German professor. But you know, a one-on-one holding the rock, he was great. He'd laugh at my jokes. He had a wonderful homily a few years ago saying that light pollution, the idea that we're blinding ourselves to the sky, is a wonderful analogy to what we do in the West by using our technology to blind ourselves to the needs of others and to the presence of God. We think we can be self-sufficient. We think that, you know, as somebody once said to me, atheism and flush toilets go together. Once you're able to take care of things, you don't have death facing you every day. You can forget that. It may not be facing you every day, but it's there. Because you can blind yourself to the poor, it doesn't mean the poor have gone away. Because you blind yourself to the stars, it doesn't mean the stars have gone away. It just means that you're refusing to look at them. And that's a sad thing. And it was the Pope Benedict who made that analogy. Somebody back there, yeah.
You said that the way objects in space act gives you insight to mm-hmm. how God follows the rules that he created. Mm-hmm. What exactly is it about the way the objects interact that makes it so you can imply the way God acts?
The first of all is that he allows things to follow the rules. He's not a nature God who moves things around. He's not a nature God who created so sloppily that he has to keep working in the gaps to make things work. But more than that, let me go back to the previous picture, okay? That's beautiful. Didn't have to be beautiful, but it is beautiful. And everyone in this room can see it's beautiful. But more than that, there are a few of us in this room, like that guy over there who teaches advanced placement physics, who can show you that not only is the light beautiful, but the Maxwell's equations that explain how that light gets transmitted to us are also beautiful. That the universe is based not only on reason, but on beauty. And beauty, as the poet said, is also truth. Truth is beauty, beauty, truth. And underlying all of this, the truth, the beauty, the reason, is a sense of love. That moment of joy you get when you discover some little thing that no one had ever seen before, but you get to see it. That burst of joy that has nothing to do with, oh, I'm going to get a tenure next year, but rather, this is wonderful. This is in itself wonderful and worth spending a lifetime doing. To my mind, that's the presence, that's the touch of God. Yeah?
Two quick questions. Is any astronomy still done at Castle Gandolfi?
On really rare occasions, there might be an occultation with Pluto in front of a star where we happen to be well situated for it. And so our telescopes still function. We can still put a camera on them. But that'll happen once every 7 or 8 years.
Second question. Is it difficult to polar align your telescope when you're inflated?
I always use an Altaz mount anyway.
Oh, okay.
So now, actually, our new telescope uses an Altaz mount, which has got its own tricks of the trade to it. I should point out that there's a lot of astronomy that's done in Castel Gandolfo. It's not done with the telescope. We have a wonderful library. We've got the meteorite collection. We've got people who are doing theoretical work. We've got one of the world's experts in string theory who works there. And we've got a lot of history of astronomy because we've got this fabulous library. So there's a lot of work being done in Castel Gandolfo. It's just not looking through a telescope. Yes?
I used to teach high school. And mm-hmm.
I've been so grateful for the last few years.
That you don't have to anymore?
For faculty who are starting and for students, just having that broader astronomy has helped them read this, but it really has helped them come to terms with the dichotomy between faith and reason and for science. So,
The Sisters of Charity of Cincinnati ran my grade school. And as a little kid, I heard of the existence of a Vatican observatory. And as a kid who was mad about astronomy, I've never forgotten it. You don't have to remember what science I do. You don't have to remember what results that I've published. All you have to remember is that we exist. And spread the word about that. Because science came out of the church. The thrust, the idea to study the universe as a way of getting to know God is based in our religion. Don't let the atheists steal it from us with their lies. Yeah?
Just a plug, the Father Spitzer is starting
a series on WTN.
Okay.
Spitzer's universe.
Good.
So,
just... He's a nice guy. I mean, we have friend of ours.
I'm from Japan, on Sato Island, right off the coast there. There's a lady selling these rocks in the shop there, and right. She said her husband had made it into a sort of like candle holder, but mm-hmm. beautiful rock, it was like jade, some gold, black gold, and it was really dense, and I was ashamed to bring back on airplane, you know, it was so heavy. What is the heaviest rock on Earth? What kind of
The meteorites that are made of iron will have a density of around 8 times the density of water, 8 grams per cc. Or a typical rock on Earth is about 2.5. A typical meteorite is about 3.5 because it's got that metallic iron in it. There are types of olivine, which in many ways is the most common rock, but you never know it because it's in the mantle of the Earth. It's not on the surface. And that will have a density of about 4.5. And 4.5 is pretty darn dense. It's rare to see a typical rock much denser than that. There are odd minerals that have density over 10, but those are really rare. Yeah, something like that, exactly. Yeah, uranium and a couple of other metals.